I was nearly unable to speak our departing liturgy for our children to go worship in another place. Perhaps you remember that. It is good and right that we come together and remember. There have been so many numbers since then, haven't there? And sometimes the numbers are so overwhelming that we forget that every number is a person. And that is why you have been given a name tonight. Hold on to this name. Every name has a story, a family, a community. So we are here tonight with a community known as Outcry. I am honored to stand beside my fellow religious leaders. We have come together across faiths. We don't agree on everything, but on this we agree, that all of our faiths call us to pursue love, to pursue justice, to pursue peace. And that means turning our prayers into action. And so tonight, our fellow Outcry leaders will invite us to remember, to pray. They will educate us following the service. We're invited out to the left and bring people to direct you into our old fellowship hall where you can learn more and educate yourself about what's happening in Georgia in terms of gun legislation. And there will be opportunities for you to be an advocate for safer gun laws, to promote peace in our neighborhoods, in our state. And so, let us gather here tonight in faith, in hope, continue together in a spirit of prayer.
I'm agree on is made of lament and confession. As I read these words, I thought about something interesting. The words that we're about to say together remind us that in this room we may come from different faith traditions. We may have different politics. We may attend different churches. We may have a myriad of differences. But these words remind us of some things that tie us all together. Independent of your background, independent of your faith tradition, independent of your politics, we all want our kids to be able to go to school safely and come home. We want to see our children grow up. We want to see our neighbors' children grow up. We want the best for our families and we want the best for our neighbors. And when a person loses their lives to senseless gun violence, no matter who you are, all of our hearts break. We lament together. So just for a few moments, let us forget about our differences. And let us remember the things that tie us all together as human beings. So if you are able, I would ask you to stand to your feet. Together, let us proclaim these words of lament and confession. Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, that we may walk the path of the Most High.
That we may lead our swords without shears, and our spears to
us. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore.
And none shall be afraid, for the mouth of the Lord is open.
We gather tonight in remembrance of all those killed by gun violence. We gather to grieve the loss of their lives.
And to lament the physical spiritual wounds that God has inflicted on individuals and the soul of our nation.
We mourn the loss of 30,000 of our brothers and sisters killed by gun violence in our country each year.
How long, Lord? How long? How long will we be a nation of mourn for ourselves, a people who have forgotten who we are?
We grieve for our brothers and sisters who had a friend, a child, a spouse, a sibling, go to the mall, the movies, a concert, a nightclub, a house of worship, and never return.
How long, Lord? How long will we be a nation of fear and fear, a people who have forgotten who we are?
Our hearts break for those traumatized and injured by gun violence, and survivors whose lives will never be the same.
How long, Lord? How long? How long will we be a nation whose prayers are deemed to words because we fail to turn them into action? Because we fail to work for systemic changes that will protect our neighbors and make our communities a safe place for all to thrive.
How long, O Lord? How long? How long will hostility and fear keep us from acknowledging our common humanity? How long will political tensions divide us and keep us from uniting as peacemakers for the common good?
We gather today to remember that we are each a child of God. We gather to claim our belongings to each other and our commitment to living the way of God's peace.
Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, that we may walk the path of the Most High.
That we may lead our swords into plowshares and our spears into us.
Neighbors shall not lift up gun against him, neither shall they learn violence anymore.
And none shall be afraid, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
In the presence of God, you may be seated.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us here this evening. You know, for at least a couple of the faith traditions that are represented here this evening, this is a very special time of year, of course. It's a time of wonder in the greatest sense, the sense of awe. It's a time of joy. It's a time also for rededication. But the truth is that the world in which you and I live is a very, very exhausting place at times. It calls upon good people like all of us here and many, many others throughout our community to do so much to seek to make a difference in so many different ways. It is exhausting. But so much beckons our attention. It calls upon us, if I can say in Jewish talk, to carry out acts of tikkun, of acts of repairing this very broken world of ours. And so amidst all of those demands, again, the frustration looms. How much so with regard to what it is that has brought us here together this evening, the issue of gun violence. I was talking with someone before we began our service here this evening. I said, isn't it just the same all the time, the two sides going at each other, no change ever really occurring? Sometimes it feels that way. And again, the frustration sets in. Can we really, really accomplish something beyond remembrance this evening? Remember, we are people of faith. Some 2,500 years ago, the prophet Isaiah spoke to another group of people, the Israelites in exile. They too were frustrated. They were scared with regard to their circumstances. They didn't know if they had the power to really make the difference that would enable them to return to the land of Israel. And so the prophet Isaiah turned to them with reassuring words. And I would suggest to you that as I read now from the 40th chapter of Isaiah, he speaks to us too. To whom then can you liken me? To whom can I be compared, says the Holy One? Lift high your eyes and see who created these. The Holy One who sends out their host by count, who calls them each by name, because of God's great might and vast power, not one fails to appear. Why do you say, O Jacob, why declare, O Israel, my ways hid from the Lord? My cause is ignored by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is God from of old, creator of the earth from end to end. The Eternal One never grows faint or weary. God's wisdom cannot be fathomed. The Holy One gives strength to the weary, fresh vigor to the spent. Youths may grow faint and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But they who trust in the Lord shall renew their strength as eagles grow new plumes. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall march and not grow faint.
Thank you.
gathered here to do the work of remembering because of the terrible homicide, and you don't need details of that from me. But I hope we're here also to strengthen one another for the work that is ahead of us, the work that is not sexy, the work that is a slog, and that's what it is. The leadership philosophy I subscribe to defines leadership as the capacity to mobilize people to address tough problems, especially problems they would rather avoid. I offer you that because we have a public safety issue in our country that requires that kind of leadership. As recently as today, in addition to the stories about Omarosa, we heard the White House press secretary, who is often never at a loss for words, go completely silent, when asked about domestic gun violence on this anniversary, specifically mass shootings. And I waited for something, but I got nothing. This is a sharp contrast to both her and the president's ability to click off possible solutions to violence perpetrated in the U.S. by foreign-born nationals. I don't think I'm being partisan to say that. I'm addicted to news, whether the red or the blue, and so this is my observation. I think it's a fair one. We have a leadership crisis in our country when it comes to this genre of public safety. And that's how I really want to characterize what we have in front of us. We have a crisis as regards public safety. I knew we were up against something monstrous when I watched the conversation of our political leaders in the wake of Sandy Hook move from a conciliatory and sympathetic response to a cowardly and insipid response. I thought to myself, and give me a little room here, I thought to myself, if they're not willing to address the issue now, finally, with policy solutions and courage, in honor of these little 20 blue-eyed, blonde-haired children, which really in our country is the summum bonum of beauty, if they're not willing to do something now, then I realized that the possibility of change was going to be unlikely. What we got from our politicians, and I'm not down on the politicians, some of my best friends are politicians, but what we got from politicians was shoulder shrugging and platitudes. We still do. And what we got was a really clear picture. And the picture that comes to mind for me was that the gun really is a cherished member of the American family. That is not to ever be questioned. I know that some would prefer, when I get going about these things, my remarks to be more along the lines of prayer and consolation, an opportunity for me to show off what I think I know about Scripture. I know some would prefer that we gather this evening and only beseech God for divine aid. But I think we must seize a better theology in the face of this dilemma. We must stop asking God for the help to do the things that God has already given us the ability to do. I think if we were able to picture God, I think it would be God rolling God's finger against something hard, waiting for us to do that which God has already equipped us to do. And while we might cry out to God, God, where are you? We are waiting. God might be saying the same thing back to us. Where are you? I am waiting. We must see the better theology. We must stop asking God for help to do the things that God has given us the ability to do. trouble that you might get with this kind of thinking and speaking on the heels of the massacre in Sutherland Springs. I woke up very, very early in the morning, which is my habit, to see this yet again. Terrible things with blood, and I wrote a brief statement, and it was entitled, "Let's Not Pray." And as you can imagine, that was of some great consternation to the Episcopal Diocese of Atlanta, where I serve as bishop. And I got amazing responses from all kinds of people, and some people worried about my relationship with the Lord. And I actually had to go back and say to them, you know, my relationship with God and my prayer life actually is robust. Don't worry about that, but I wanted to make a point to them. And so I'll give you a little bit of that statement. It's entitled, "Let's Not Pray." As someone who convenes and commends prayer for a living, what America needs now is less prayer and more action from her elected officials. When the doers of evil are far and mourn, suggestions for policy and action flow forward. When the doers of evil are Americans with semi-automatic weapons, they are invited to moments of silence and prayer only. Silence is what we use to hear God speak, not a place to hide my responsibility. Prayer is not a refuge for cowards. Prayer is where we steel ourselves to partner with God for good. I went on to say, please do not invite me to Springs, Texas, unless it is to pray courage over elected officials who intend to work for the ban of semi-automatic weapons. You can see why that garnered the most comments and or responses that I have gotten. Of all the things I've been writing, I write every Friday for more than 5 years now as bishop. I've not posted anything that's gotten more comments than that. What I would say to us now is that prayer with no corresponding action is useless. Mm-hmm. It goes no higher than the ceiling. It's a vain exercise. Most importantly, prayer without action is not the faith that Jesus practiced. It is not the faith of a faithful Jew. It is not the faith of a faithful Muslim. It is not the faith in goodwill of any person of goodwill. If prayer is responding to God, then as it regards the public safety danger of semi-automatic weapons in our society, we might take the advice of Nicholas Kristof in his article in the New York Times dated November 7th. If you haven't read that, please look that up. Nicholas Kristof wrote a wonderful article I thought which was balanced and fair politically, but offered solutions. It was posted in the New York Times on November 7th. It was entitled, "How to Reduce Shootings." He reminds us, just a couple of factoids, he reminds us that America has more guns than any other country. He states, where guns are regulated, and the data speaks beyond the politics, in states where guns are regulated, there are fewer gun deaths. He goes on to say, it offend equally, traditional liberal opposition to guns has been ineffective and sometimes counterproductive. What is needed is a public approach, he recommends, modeled exactly after the automotive industry's push toward new safety standards. You remember when cars didn't have seatbelts? How did we get here? By a sustained conversation and action towards public safety. He reminds us that most gun deaths are suicides, not homicides or mass shootings. There's something there for us around mental health. Data shows, and this is really the piece here, and I'm coming to the end. Here's the opportunity. Data shows that there are compelling numbers of gun-owning households that agree with preserving the Second Amendment, while at the same time, Did you hear that? Which means there's an opportunity for a conversation. So I believe this leaves us and people beyond this place with a mandate to adopt a new strategy for having the conversation that is necessary, and if the data is to be believed, that is possible. To stop speaking exclusively to those who already agree with us. And to commit to not assigning the worst motives to those who sit on the opposite side of the conversation. To find non-traditional allies who can put their imprimatur on something that we cobble together and push forward. A word of confession. Taking up this issue with folks in Outcry and others, what I realized in my own self was that I'm pretty good at making statements. I know how to work with a microphone, but I realized where I was short was actually convening, inviting people who are part of the gun lobby or the NRA to coffee. And so I'm challenging myself in 2018 to have those conversations with folks where I find the capacity to be with people, to use the data to have a conversation and perhaps put a stake in the ground. So that's my confession. How about you? I personally have come to this new clarity that statements alone will not get us there. Statements are necessary. And fine sounding, that has its place. And we've got to do the things that we're doing tonight. But the holy books talk about the hard work of fellowship. All of our holy books talk about the hard work of fellowship. And that, I think, is our call going forward. Christoph finishes by saying, yes, making America safer will be hard. There are no perfect solutions. The Second Amendment is one constraint, and so is our polarized political system and the power of the gun lobby. It's unclear how effective some of his suggestions will be, and in any case, this will be a long, uncertain, uphill process. But automobiles are a reminder that we can chip away at a large problem through a public health approach. Just as auto safety improvements have left us far better off, it seems plausible to some gun policy experts that a sensible, politically feasible set of public health steps could, over time, reduce firearm deaths in America by one-third, or more than 10,000 lives saved each year. That's something. So let's not just shed tears, he says, for the dead, or give somber speeches and lower flags. Let's get started and save lives. Let tonight be to us and others like the sound of the shofar. Piercing, jarring, awakening, a call to action. Amen.
Brothers and sisters. He said, the end of prayer is not amen, but action. What are we going to be doing today? And what do we promise ourselves to do? To be that element of change that brings peace to our world. In the Islamic tradition as well, God says, God will help those who help themselves. So, what are we doing? Please join me in prayers. Oh, merciful one, inspire us with the wisdom and vision of peace and the gift of holiness. Give us wisdom to seek nonviolence as an answer to the violence of our lives and world. Give us courage to seek wholeness in a fractured and divided world, to find reconciliation rather than revenge, to abandon the instruments of violence and death, and entrust our lives, our homes, and our families to you, O God. May your presence fill us with the thirst of unity. May your presence fill us with the thirst for unity, wholeness, and the desire to see all people valued. May we be instruments of your love. Blessed be your name forever, God. Amen.
Amen.
Bishop Wright has reminded us that this work is a slog. It is hard work, and we rarely see much progress. But we must keep doing it. We must keep doing it. Why does public safety matter to people of faith? Because when people are not safe, they are afraid. And fear begets violence, and violence begets fear, and fear begets violence, and the cycle continues. And we have got to work together to break that cycle, to create safe places where people can thrive in peace and grow in joy. This is our work. It's a slog. And why do we do it? Look at the name in your hand. We do it so that Brandon Scott is my name. That Brandon Scott's friends, that Brandon Scott's family, people in this community and other people like Brandon Scott can live and be safe. We do it for Brandon Scott because his life has been ended by gun violence. We do it because, as Samaya reminded us, if we save one Brandon Scott, we save humanity. And that is our calling. That is to repair the world. So we come tonight and we're going to end our night with a ritual. We're going to end this part of our night. Again, I invite you to continue this prayer with your action as we head down to the old fellowship hall, where we will have opportunities for us to put our prayers into action. But we are going to end this part by praying together, by committing ourselves to the ways of peace. As we come forward, you have also been given a name and a candle. You know, our Quaker brothers and sisters say it this way, that in every human life there is a divine spark. The image of God is in every human life. And the people that we will name, their light has been put out by a gun. the divine spark that was in them continues to shine by continuing to work, to do the work, to slog through it together until there are changes. And so we invite you to come forward, to bring your candle and bring your name and bring your bulletin. You're holding a lot. When you light your candle, you may say your name that you have out loud or silently. And then we will circle in this area, and together we will sing a closing song, "Let There Be Peace on Earth," and it will be our commitment to being peacemakers, to turning our prayers into action. So we invite you to come forward.
Dennis Neil Johnson, Sr.
Richard Vaughn Cummins.
Josephine Gray.
Alan Martinez.
John Joseph Griffin.
Mary Schumann.
Caroline Brabidi.
Noah Holcomb, age one.
Unborn baby, Holcomb.
Lisa Marie Patterson.
Emily Garcia.
Benjamin Wheeler.
Arlen Twain, Holcomb.
Jamaica Smith.
Brett Schwanbeck.
Donald Matthews.
Sakia Johnson.
Jacorbin King.
Charles Roberson.
Grace McCombe.
Jamie Shore.
Candace Ryan Dollars.
Jeff.
Colin Adepi.
Sarah John Johnson.
Robert Lewis. Jesse Lewis.
Noah Gilmore.
Rachel Davina.
James Scott.
James Kowalski. Steph. Emily Rose Hill.
Gregory Lynn Hill, age 16.
Rasheen Sterling, a minor.
Kerry Ray Barnett.
All those who go unnamed. Continue to fellowship and to slog through this work.